Today we will see an explicit example of a process that we will calculate from the beginning to the end. So, and to show you as an example how to indeed relate the parameter of the theory, the interaction, the Lagrangian that we discussed so far in the course with the observables that you can measure. Last time we arrived to an expression for the so-called differential cross-section, d sigma, which was given by the modulus square of the scattering amplitude between two particles with momenta pa and pb, if you remember, going to some final state of n particle with momenta qi, modulus square. There was a prefactor, it was 4 omega a omega b, which are the energies of the two particles a and b, and the relative velocity delta b a b of the two incoming particles. Then there was a factor, the delta function, which was enforcing the 4 momentum conservation between the initial state a plus qb and the final one, q dot. And finally, there was the differential part, which was the so-called phase space of the n particle states at the edge. So this was the formula for the differential cross-section. Now we're going to discuss a little bit more the formula, and then we'll start with the process. So we can rewrite the factor here in a particular case, the so-called center of mass case, in which basically we set ourselves in the frame where basically the center of mass frame, which is basically the frame where PA plus, or if you want, PA vector is equal to minus PB 3 vector. Okay? So that the total 3 momentum is 0. So in this case, this factor here then would be, I remind you that this factor here was 4 omega a omega b, and delta b was nothing else, well, the modulus was nothing else but p a parallel f vector over omega a minus p b. Now in the center of mass frame, p a is equal to minus p b, so we can put p a outside. So this is also equal to 4 omega a omega b modulus of, let's say, pa. And then you have 1 over omega a minus, plus 1 over omega b, which is omega a plus omega b over omega a omega b. So this is just omega a plus omega b over the product, which then simplifies. And this omega a plus omega b, nothing else is the total energy, right? The sum of the energy of the two particles. Sometimes this expression is written in terms of the so-called Mandelstam variable S, which is just the sum of the 4 momenta squared. So in the center of mass frame, this is nothing else than just the 0 component square of a plus pb, which is just omega a plus omega b square. So this object here is also equal to root s. So this factor here can also be written as 4 root s times the modulus of the 3 momentum of one of the particles. It doesn't matter because in the center of mass frame they have the same 3 momentum. Now we're going to discuss instead this other factor here, the phase space. Of course, in the general case where you have an n particle, in general this is a very complicated expression. I'm going to simplify for you the simplest probably case, which is the case when you have only two particles in the final state. If you remember, we commented on the fact that if you are a small coupling, like in QED, the probability to emit many particles is suppressed by higher powers of the coupling. So basically, the final state with the least number of particles is the most probable one, typically. So how this factor now look like in the special case n equal to 2? Well, you remember this d phi n is just the integral, sorry, the differential d3p, sorry, we call it q. Q1 for the first particle over the factor 2 pi q, 2 omega q1, d3q2 over 2 pi q, 2 omega q2. Now, in this particular case, the delta here actually constrained Q1 and Q2 almost completely. And we see that it leaves as a freedom only the angular direction of the three momenta of the final particles. So I'm going to consider the product of this d phi with the delta function here together. I'm going to add also the factor 2 pi to the 4, delta 4, of pa plus qb, minus q dot, which is q1 minus q2. Right? So we have 4 deltas and 6 integrals. So eventually we'll be only left with 2 integrals. We can use the delta to remove 4 of them. Since this object here is already written in a Lorentz invariant way, it would be simplifies our life if we rewrite also this in a simpler way. You can write this factor here as usual, as the differential over the 4 momenta q2 over 2 pi cube, if you want, delta of q2 squared minus m2 squared, the mass of the second particle, and the step function q2. So this object here is exactly equivalent to that one, right? Because the delta just fixes q0 to be on shell, to be omega q2, and from the derivative you get the factor 1 over 2 omega. And now we can use the delta function here to remove the 4 integrals here. And 2 pi cube remove the factor of 4 here. So this object here is also equal then to what? Well, we have the differential in d3q1 over 2 pi squared, because you have cube and 1 power here, a factor of 2 omega q1, and then this delta function, this delta of q2 minus m squared. Now remember that we used the delta function to remove the dependence of q2. So q2 is fixed to be this combination, right, by the delta function. So the actual q2 here is nothing else than pa plus pb minus q1 squared minus m2 squared. And the step function here that just tells you to pick up only, if you want, the solution of this delta function with q2, which is this combination possible. So let me write the argument of this delta function a little bit more explicitly. And as before, let me, for simplicity, work on the central mass plane. Of course, the final result is Lorentz invariant, so it doesn't matter in which frame you work, but the expression, let me write it in terms of the variables of that frame. So you remember, so if I span the square, let me span in such a way that I put these two guys together, PA plus PB. So PA plus PB square is nothing else what we call S, right? Then we have Q1 square, but Q1 square is just the mass of the first particle square. And then you have the double product of these two guys. And the double product of these two guys is minus 2 Q1 PA plus PB. Now in the center of mass frame, this is nothing else that omega 1, right? Omega Q1, the zero component of Q1, and the zero component of PA plus PB, which is omega A plus omega B, which is root S. And then we have finally minus M. This is the argument of the delta. Now this guy here, let me write it in terms of, this is the tree vector Q1, let me write it in terms of the modulus and the angular variables. So this is also the modulus of Q1, modulus of Q1 square, d omega, which is the differential of the two angular variables, right? D times phi of the three momentum, some frame. So finally we have this guy over 2 pi square, 2 omega Q1. And now you see that this delta function just fixes, can use it to fix Q1 here, the modulus, because the modulus of Q1, it's inside omega Q1, right? Omega Q1 is square root of Q1 square plus M1 square. So this is fixes basically Q1 to the value set by this delta function, and the delta function just releases a factor which is 1 over the derivative of the argument with respect to modulus of Q1. And this means the derivative of the argument is just 2 root s d omega Q1 over d modulus of Q1. In modulus. So this delta removes this factor here and basically fixes modulus of Q1 to satisfy this equation, this equal to zero, which is just a three momentum conservation. Or equivalently, it fixes basically omega Q1, which is the energy of the Q1 particle, to be what? To be S, I don't know if you can read it, S plus M1 squared minus M2 squared over 2 root S. Can you read it? Now, the derivative of omega Q1 with respect to Q1 is nothing else than Q1 over omega Q1. So this object here is just, let me write it all. This factor here is just root 2 root s Q1 in modulus over omega Q1. So let me write eventually here the result. So we have Q1 modulo square over Q1. So there is a modulus of Q1 in the numerator. A d omega. Well, let me add it again. Then you have omega Q1, which simplifies with this omega Q1 here. And these 2 and 2 become 4. This denominator, we have a 4 times a 2 pi square. And what? If I'm correct, and there is a root s. And the omega in the numerator. So here Q1 in modulus is fixed, right, by momentum conservation to be such that this equation is satisfied. So out of these 6 differentials and 1 delta, you are left just with 2 differentials, which are the 2 angles of integration here, of the direction of basically of the final three momentum, and all the modulus of the final momenta and energy are fixed by momentum conservation. There is this numerical factor here, which is a function of the three momentum modulus and the total energy, the total energy in the center of mass frame. So now we can put everything together. And write the differential cross-section for the case you have two particles in the initial state and two particles in the final state in the center of mass frame. Let me divide by the angle differential d omega. So this is simply, here I have a factor of 4 root s PA, and here you have another factor of 4, 2 pi square Q1, so there is, let's say, the factor of modulus of Q1 over modulus of PA, the initial three momentum and the final three momentum in the central mass frame, a numerical factor which is 4 times 4, let me write it like this. 4 pi square. I don't know why I'm writing it this way. Times 4 s. So there is a root s, and root s give you s. 4. What 4 I put it inside here. So it's 4 pi square. And the other 4 I put it outside. I don't know why I put it like this in the notes. And then there is, yes, the modulus square of s. And 2 to 2. And that's it. So this is the differential cross-section per unit angle, right? So this object here cannot depend, so it would depend, well, basically Q1 and PA are fixed by momentum conservation, the relative size. So this amplitude, modulus square, will depend on the four momenta of the incoming and final particle, which are however related by momentum conservation. So it would be still a function of basically S. And will depend also in general on the final angle of the outgoing particle. And this gives you basically something that is proportional to the number of events that you expect at any fixed angle. And then if you integrate over the angles, you get the number of events for the region of angles that you consider. This final integration of angle, we cannot do it, right, because we don't have any delta left. In general, this object here depends on the angles, so you have to integrate only after having computed the angular dependence that comes from the interactions that you have in your problem. Okay. Any question?
Professor?
Yes.
The last data there, I don't know how it got reduced to that expression.
This delta here?
Plus 1 squared.
This one?
Yes.
From here to here?
Yeah. How you got this? Exactly.
So, PA plus PB, I now erase it. I called S the quantity PA plus PB squared. Okay? So, when I expand this square, I have PA plus PB squared. By definition, I call it S. Okay? Then I have a Q1 squared. These are four vectors, right? So Q1 squared is just the mass of the particle 1 squared. And then I have the double product, which is minus 2 Q1 times PA plus PB. Now, PA plus PB in the center of mass frame, by definition, is a four vector, which is PA plus PB 0 for the 0 component, and 0 for the 3 component, because the 3 component of PA cancel with the 3 component of PB. It's the definition of center of mass. So you have only the 0 component, and the 0 component is basically the sum of the energies, right? So which is square root of S. So this is also PA 0 plus PB 0 squared. So this is the square root of S here, and the 0 component of Q1 is what we call omega Q1, the energy of the... And then you have minus M2 squared. Okay?
I get it now, thank you.
All right. Any other question?
And for the final expression that we have,
yes.
If we integrate over the angle,
yes.
We will get the scattering cross section. So I want to know the angle, is it a fixed one, like kind of solid angle, or it depends on the system you have?
No, it's in general can be any angle. So for the 2-2-2 scattering, so you have two incoming particles, right? Let's say in the center of mass frame. So this is PA and this is PB of the incoming particles. They collide and then two other particles emerge. In general, in the center, since you're in the center mass frame, the total momentum will still be zero. So the two particles, Q1 and Q2, will emerge opposite to each other. But the angles with which they emerge, right, theta and phi, if you want, can be arbitrary. Because any choice of the angle is compatible with the four momentum conservation. Four momentum conservation only fixes the modulus of, because it fixes the conservation of energy and the modulus of the momenta, right? But it doesn't fix the angle. So the angle can be anything. In general, you'll find that this amplitude might depend, in general, on the angles, theta and phi. And then it means that the number, the probability that the particle emerge at some angle is different as a function of the angle. So sometimes the more particle will emit orthogonal to the direction of interaction, or sometimes they will emerge more probably on the same line. Depends, this information really depends on what kind of interaction you have. And in fact, measuring the angular distribution of the events of the collision provides useful information to reconstruct the type of interaction that you have in your theory. Okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
All right. Any other question? Otherwise, we will go now to indeed compute one of this kind of processes explicitly. We will see indeed that there is some non-trivial angular dependence. If there are no questions, I'm going to erase the whole blackboard. So the process that we are going to compute today is probably the simplest you can imagine, the simplest non-trivial scattering process you may imagine, and it's also the most representative because it provides with the way, basically, in colliders, you can explore new physics and check the degrees of freedom and discover new degrees of freedom in the theory. So the process I'm going to consider today is the process where you scatter an electron and a positron. And from this process, you produce two heavier particles, the muon and the antimuon. So the Lagrangian, in this case, we're going to consider is just the sum of two Lagrangians, right? Well, the Lagrangian of QED with the electron, with two fermions, electron and muons. They are represented by two different fermions, Dirac, with two different masses, but same charge under electromagnetic interactions. Well, in principle, you can put different charges and then perform this kind of experiment to actually measure, as we will see, the charges. And for the first example we're going to consider today, we're going to consider the case where we don't measure or take into account the spin of the particle. So what you're going to measure is just scatter two electron, an electron and a positron of arbitrary spin, and measure the muons that come out from this process without measuring the spin. So this is called also an unpolarized cross section. I will explain a little bit more this as we will go through the example. So as I described already before, let me call now give names to the kinematics. We are going to give name to the momenta of the initial infinite particles. I'm going to call, let's say that this is the electron and this is the positron, which collide in momentum P1 and P2. And the two muons, the muon and the antimuon, that emerge from this collision, then we call the momenta Q1 and Q2. Okay? So, in this case, S, so before is P1 plus P2 whole square. And for now, let me not specify more all the number. We're in the center of mass frame, and I will write the formula later when we need it. Okay? So we want to compute this process. So how do we do it? First thing to do, right, is to write all possible Feynman diagrams that you can write at the lowest order in perturbation theory, which basically connect the initial state with the final state. So our initial state is an electron and a positron. There's always time flows from left to right in my case. And the final state is a muon and a antimuon. Okay. So this is momentum P1, P2, Q1, Q2. Okay. So you remember the scattering of two particles into two particles in QD happens at the second order in perturbation theory. You have to insert at least two vertices. So we need at least one vertex, right, with one electron and one positron, because we need at least one electron and one positron field, right, to annihilate the initial states. And similarly, we need another vertex with a muon and antimuon. To produce the final muons. And the photon, which does not appear in the final state, must be a contraction, so it must connect the two vertices. So at the end, the only possibility you have at this order in perturbation theory is just to connect the lines in this way. So there is only one final diagram that you can draw at this order in perturbation theory that mediate this process. That's why this is the simplest, one of the simplest processes, because it only involves one Feynman diagram. Okay? Let me write it a little bit more nicely. Okay. Okay, so this is the Feynman diagram, and now from here we want to compute the scattering amplitude that we had to put in the formula we wrote before about the cross-section. So all we have to compute now is the scattering amplitude M. And for doing that, we're going to follow all the rules that we already overviewed a couple of lectures ago. Okay, so first thing, let me assign all the momenta. So we call already P1 and P2 the external momenta of the incoming particle, and Q1 and Q2 the external momenta of the outgoing particles. So the only line that I still have to assign momentum is the photon line, the internal propagator. And this is fixed, since this is a three-level diagram, right? It will be fixed by energy momentum conservation, so the momentum that flows in this line must be the sum of P1 plus P2 for momentum conservation from here, which is also equal to Q1 plus Q2, since it must match also for the final state. So either of the two is okay, because eventually P1 plus P2 must be equal to P1 plus Q2. And then we just name, as we want, the vertices with the Lorentz index mu and nu for the gamma matrix that we are going to put on that vertex. And now we are all set to start writing the amplitude explicitly. So our amplitude, our IM, is given by. So what are the rules? If you remember, all we have to do, we can start writing the contribution from the fermion lines. And all we have to do is to follow each fermion line backwards with respect to the arrow. So we start from here, for example. This is an antiparticle, antipositron, right? So the initial antiparticle is a factor of V bar with momentum P2, and in general this will have some helicity, right? Let me call this helicity H2, okay? So let me write also the helicity of the initial state, H1, H2, and the helicity of the final state, H1 prime, H2 prime, okay? So this is the force spinor that describes the initial antiparticle. Then we arrive here. Here we have a vertex, so this we call it mu, so we have a gamma mu, and also a factor of I charge, right? I will call it QE. And then from here, we go this way. This is an incoming particle, electron, so we have to add the spin of U with momentum P1 and velocity H1. And now you see, this is end of this fermion line and all the fermionic indices are saturated. Now we add the factor coming from the second fermion line. Again, we start going backwards with the line, so we have to start from here. This is a, now this is a particle, because it's a muon, it's a particle, so it's a U bar with momentum Q1 and velocity H1 prime. Then we have a vertex, this gives you a factor of gamma nu and another factor of IQ. So okay, let me already assume that the charge of the electron and the charge of the muon are the same. So I write it as IQE squared. You could have left them independent if you didn't know. And then the last factor here, this is an antiparticle, anti-muon, right? So this is described by a B for vector with momentum Q2. And velocity H2 prime. So again, also in this factor, all the fermionic indices, spin indices are contracted very well. And then the final factor comes from the internal propagator of the photon. So you remember the propagator of the photon gives you a factor which is minus I G mu nu, and I'm writing the formula in the Feynman gauge, like psi is equal to 1, so there is only in the numerator, it's just G mu nu, and over the four momentum square that flows along its line, which in this case is P1 plus P2. So this is it. This is the probability amplitude written in terms of the spinors and the momenta of the probe. You can further simplify, right? Let me write it downstairs here. This is also equal to I squared minus plus I QE squared. P1 plus P2 squared is what we call S. So this is over S. So G mu nu, you basically can use to lower one of these indices, so you are just left with D bar P2 H2 gamma mu U P1 H1 U bar Q1 H1 prime gamma lower mu V Q2 H2 prime, etc. Now if you wanted to describe a particular amplitude with a particular helicity for the initial and final states, you can just replace the explicit form for the spinors, U and V, in any basis you want, for gamma matrices like Pauli-Dirac, which basically describe the four spinor with that helicity. You can plug it inside here, you get an explicit expression in terms of P1, P2, Q1, Q2, and the density plus or minus for this. We, however, of course, the special will be longer, a little bit more ugly. We will, however, be interested for the moment only in the case where we don't track the information of the spin, just track the for momentum of the particles. So what we were going to do eventually is basically to sum over all possible spins for the final state, because we don't care what spin it comes from, so we sum over all possible final state to the same for momentum, independently of the spin, and we average over the initial helicities of the incoming particle, because we don't know what helicity are, so we just take the average. However, before doing that, we first need to compute the modulo square of the amplitude, which is actually the probability that will enter inside the final formula. So what the modulo square of this guy is, well, there will be a factor of QE to the 4 over S squared. And then we have to square these objects. Let me square each of these factors one by one. So I write this guy first, V bar P2H2 gamma mu UP1H1. Now I have to multiply the complex conjugate, which is equal to taking the Hermitian conjugate of each of these spinor and gamma matrices. So I will get the U dagger, gamma mu dagger, gamma naught, V. And then I can use the fact that gamma mu dagger is equal to gamma naught, gamma mu, gamma naught, to rewrite this as U bar P1 H1 gamma, let me now call this nu, B P2 H2. So this mu index here is saturated with this, right? So when I take the modulo, if I take this object times its complex conjugate, the complex conjugate will have two gamma matrices, which also are saturated between themselves, and the dummy variable, I have to call it in a different way, which is nu, which is this nu here, okay? So this is just this the first factor modulo square. Now I'm going to add also the second factor modulo square. So I'm going to copy first this, which is U bar Q1H1 gamma mu VQ2H2 prime, and then I take the complex conjugate, which will be V bar Q2H2 prime gamma mu UQ1. Questions? Okay, as I said before, I'm not interested about the spin, so I'm going to do the following. I'm going to consider M modulo square, but I'm going to sum over the final helicities, which I call H1 prime and H2 prime, And then I'm going to average over the initial elasticities. So I sum over H1 and H2, and I divide it by 1/2 squared, which is the average, right? I take 1/2 of the sum of the two spin, for the two elasticities, for each of the two particles. So this is what is called now the unpolarized probability. And you see that by taking this average and this sum, you will simplify the expression, because we will not need anymore to use the explicit expression for the for spinors. I can write it in a more useful way. So, and the reason for this is the following. When you sum over, for example, let's say that we sum with respect to H1. H1 only appears here and here, right? It's the elasticity of these two guys. So you see that when we sum over H1, we are basically considering the sum over H1 of this UP1 H1, UP1 bar H1. But now if you go back to your notes, you'll recognize here, by the completeness relation of the four spinors, that the sum over spins of UU bar, it just gives you the projector over the U spinors for the momentum P1, which, if you remember, was of the form P1 slash plus M1. Sorry, M1 here is the mass of this particle, let me call it the mass of the electron, right? And E. Now, notice one thing, that here the index of this guy was saturated with this gamma matrix. The index of this guy was saturated with this other gamma matrix. So when you sum U, U bar, you get a matrix in spinor space, whose indices are saturated with this gamma matrix and this other gamma matrix. So eventually this will give you a factor here, a matrix P1 slash plus ME, that you have to insert in substitution of these two spinors here, and will basically connect the indices of this gamma matrix with the indices of this gamma matrix. Analogously, when you sum over H2, basically, you sum this spinor here and this spinor here. In that case, so you get from here and there, you get the factor which is sum over H2 VP2 H2 V bar, you can take from here P2 H2. This sum here now gives you the projector over the B spinor, which, if you remember, is of the form P2 slash minus M. And again, now this matrix here, P2 slash minus M, have one index saturated with this gamma matrix, and the other index is saturating here with this other gamma matrix. So you see now that all the indices saturate themselves in a cyclic way. You start from here, then you saturate with this, then saturate with this, then you saturate with this, and then you go back to here. Which means that if you write as matrices, you get a trace. So let me write it down here. So this object eventually will give you a QE to the 4 over S squared trace of what? Well, let's start from here. Gamma mu P1 slash plus ME gamma nu P2 slash minus ME. And there was a factor of 1/4. And then I can perform exactly the same sum here. So this will be another trace. From here, gamma mu. This will be a factor of q2/(m). And now the mass of this spinor is the muon mass, so let me call it m mu. Gamma nu. And then u bar gives you a q1/ plus m. Questions?
Professor?
Yes.
You think when we did a completeness relation, we think we had like over 2n the projector. I'm not sure if it is the case. I think it was.
Yes. Yes. So the projector itself was the sum over h, for example, of u bar over 2m. And this was giving p/(m) over 2m. Okay. Now we have only the numerator, so I wrote only the numerator. Okay? Any other question? So, thanks to these sums of ellipses, we were able basically to get rid of the explicit four spinors expressions and just rewrite them as traces of gamma matrices and four moments. So now what we had to do is just to perform these traces explicitly, and eventually we'll get just an expression in terms of the four momenta and scalar product of four momenta. So now to proceed, we need to look at the properties of gamma matrices and their traces. So I don't know if you went through these rules and formula with in RQM. They are very simple rules to derive. If not, you can find in any books of QFT, in the appendices typically they are reported. And basically, the rules are simple. All traces of all the number of gamma matrices are zero. And the only traces that are non-zero are traces of even number of products of an even number of gamma matrices. Traces of two gamma matrices give you 4 times g mu nu, and traces of 4 gamma matrices give you a bunch of product of g mu nu. So I'm going to use those explicitly. So let me just do an example explicitly here. Just let's consider this trace here. We call it trace A. So let's start with the simplest factor. Let's take the factor count from the mass here and the mass there. So this is equal to minus the mass of the electron square times the trace of gamma mu gamma nu. The trace of gamma mu gamma nu is just 4 g mu nu. Right, because gamma mu gamma nu is a cyclic, can write as 1/2 the anticommutator. The commutator is equal to 2 g mu nu. So eventually get g mu nu, the trace of the identity, which is 4. Then instead you have another factor. This is a little bit more complicated because it's gamma nu. So the off-diagonal pieces are the odd number of gamma matrices, so the only other contribution comes from where you take a gamma matrix from here and gamma matrix from there. So you have four gamma matrices in the product, in the trace. So this object is proportional to the P1, let me call it rho, P2 sigma, trace, or gamma mu, gamma rho, let me put rho and sigma below, gamma mu, gamma rho, gamma nu, gamma sigma. I wrote the 2p slash explicitly. Now, this trace here, if I remember correctly, is given by 4 times, basically all combination of g mu nu and 0 sigma that you can write, so it's 4 g mu rho g mu sigma plus g mu sigma g mu rho minus g mu nu g rho sigma. To derive this expression, you can use basically just have to use the anti-commutation properties of the gamma matrix. And since this object must perform as a 4 tensor, the most general 4 tensor that you have, this invariant is this one, and then the prefactor is just fixed by saturating the gamma matrix. You can see with matrix, you can see the derivation in your book. Okay, so now if you use P1 rho and P2 sigma here, you get that the final expression for A is there's a 4 from here and 4 from there, so there's an overall factor of 4, and then you get P1 mu, P2 nu from here, plus P1 nu, P2 mu from the second term, minus the third term is just P1, P2, G mu nu, and there is also minus here, let me call it then, plus M E square G mu nu. So this is this factor A, and the factor B is basically equivalent, except that you have the mass of the muon instead of mass of the electron, and Q1 and Q2 instead of P1 and P2. So I'm going to write here my N square unpolarized. So this is the factor of Q to the 4 over 4 S square. Then there will be a factor of 4 from here, this trace, and there will be another factor of 4 from the second trace, which is 16, or if you want, a 4 in the numerator. And then I have this guy here, saturated with the analogous guy there. So let me write it this way. P1 mu, P2 mu, plus P1 mu, P2 mu, minus G mu nu P1 P2 minus P plus M E square, and this multiplies, let me write it back here, Q1 mu Q2 mu plus Q1 mu Q2 mu minus G mu mu Q1 Q2 plus M mu 1. Okay? So now we have to do this nice product. Okay, let's do it. So when you develop this times this, and this times this are the same. So you get 4q squared to the 4 over s squared. This will be p1 q1 times p2 q2. And this gives you exactly the same, so there is a factor of 2 in front. And then there is this times this and this times that, which is instead P1 Q2, P2 Q1, and also there are two of them, so it's 2 P1 Q2, P2 Q1. And these are basically all the products of these two with these two. Then there are products of these with this, so give you G mu nu, sorry, I should have written the mu nu here lower. So here you have G mu nu, which give you 4. And this factor times this factor, right? So P1, Q2 plus ME squared times Q1, Q2 plus ME mu squared. And finally, there is the product of this term with this term and this term with this term. So this times this give you a minus. G mu nu P1 P2 plus P2 P1 is twice P1 P2, right? So there is a factor of 2, P1 P2 times this, which is Q1 Q2 plus M mu squared. And then this times this, which is minus 2 Q1 Q2 from this product times this factor here, which is P1, P2 plus ME squared. You see, so at the end you get just an expression in terms of scalar products of four momenta. Any questions before I raise this part? Okay, now we have to rewrite in a nicer way all these factors here. So now we need to do a little bit of exercise of kinematics. So I'm going to write explicitly this P1, P2, Q1 and Q2, and you see that all these products are actually a little bit redundant because they are all similar to each other. So let me call in the center mass frame P1 mu is of the form E P1 trivector, right? P2 mu, remember this is the same particle with the same mass, well, it's the antiparticle, this is the same mass, in the center of mass frame, has the same energy and opposite three momentum. Similar for the muon, Q1 mu would be some the energy will be the same because the energy is conserved in the center of mass frame is split between the two particles. the three momentum will be different because the mass is different. So this is Q1. And for the antiparticle on the final state, you have energy and minus Q1. So if you assign this name, S is also equal to, well, it's the, is P1 plus P2 squared in the center mass frame, which basically is E plus E squared, which is 4E squared. Four times the energy of a single electron squared. And now we can compute all possible products of P's and Q's between themselves. So, let's see. P1, P2. Well, P1, P2, you can write it as P1 plus P2 squared minus P1 squared minus P2 squared, so that only the double product remains, and then you divide by 2, right? So this is equal to P1, P2. But P1 plus P2 squared is what we call S. P1 squared and P2 squared are, P1 and P2 squared are, so this is S over 2, the first factor. And then P1 and P2 squared are M squared and M squared, so you get twice M squared over 2, which is just M E squared. And the same for Q1, Q2, which then will give you S over 2 minus the mass of the muon squared. And now we need just the cross terms, P1 with Q1, P2 with Q2, P1 with Q2, P1. So, let me write it here. P1, Q1. Well, if you do P1, Q1, you get E squared minus P1, Q1, right? The three vector. So this is E squared minus P1, Q1, which I can write as P1, Q1, cosine theta. If I call theta the angle between the three momentum P1 and the three momentum Q1. What about P2, Q2? Well, you see, P2, Q2 is the same as P1, Q1. Because you flip a sign here, and you flip a sign here. So the product is exactly the same. So P2, Q2 is equal to P1, Q1. And then we do the cross product. P1, Q2. P1, Q2 from here is E squared plus P1, Q1, cosine theta, because you get an extra minus sign in the product with the three momenta. And analogously, P2, Q1 is equal to P1, Q2, because you just flip twice the sign. So P2, Q1 is equal to P1, Q2. And that's it. These are all the possible combinations of products of four momenta. So now we can use this formula here, inside here, so to rewrite everything in just in terms of the energy of the particle, the angle, and the masses. Alright, so let me do the first simplifications. P2, Q2 is equal to P1, Q1. So P2, Q2 is equal to P1, Q1. So this I can do, write it as square. P2, Q1 is equal to P1, Q2. This is also square of this. And the rest I cannot simplify. yet. So now let me write it explicitly. So we're here. I hope the space is enough. I'm going to write this here as, let's see, QE to the 4 S squared is 4E squared, so it's 16E to the 4, with the 4 is 4E to the 4. This is the prefactor. Let me put also maybe the factor of this factor of 2 outside, no? 2 4 becomes 2 and 2 outside, so this becomes a 2. Now we have P1 Q1 square. Okay, P1 Q1 square, I read it from here, there. So this is a factor of E square minus P1 Q1 cos theta square. Then I have P1 Q2 squared. So it's plus the same thing, but P1 Q2 is just with the plus. And I wrote these two terms here. Now I have this term here, which is P1 P2 plus ME squared. P1 P2 plus ME squared is just S over 2. So this term here is just S over 2. And this term here also is just S over 2. From here, Q1, Q2 plus and mu squared is equal to S over 2. So this term here is just S squared over 4 times 2 is S squared over 2. And so let me write it just as S squared over 2 is just 6/8 into the 4. And then I have this guy, so this is again Q1 Q2 plus mu squared is S over 2. This is also S over 2. While P1 P2 and Q1 Q2 are this guy here. So I have minus P1 P2, which is, I mean, S over 2 minus ME squared times S over 2 minus S over 2 minus ME squared over S over 2 times S over 2. Actually, let me rewrite these terms. Otherwise, it's like 2 S over 2 squared. So now you see that this term here simplifies with this and this. So you're only left here with two terms, which are S over 2, which is 2E squared, times ME squared plus ME squared. So this term here just gives you a factor, which is S over 2, which is 2E squared ME squared plus ME squared. What about this? Let me write it now explicitly. You have E squared, E to the 4 plus E to the 4. So it's 2 from here gets 2 e to the 4. The double product from here simplifies with the double product from there. And then you have this square plus this square, which is twice p1 squared, q1 squared, cos squared theta. Okay, I'm almost there. Because now, let me... let me write this. Now let me bring this 2e to the 4 inside. So I can write this as qe to the 4 multiplies 2e to the 4 over 2e to the 4 is 1. Plus, let me write first that 2e squared over 2e to the 4 is 1 over e squared, so it's n e squared plus m mu squared over e squared plus, so divided by 2e to the 4, and I get p1 squared over e squared, q1 squared over e squared plus cos theta squared. p1 squared I can also write as e squared minus m e squared, and this I can also write as e squared minus m e squared. So I do that, so I can write it as 1 plus minus m e squared over e squared, 1 minus m mu squared over e squared, cosine squared. And that's it. I hope I didn't make any mistake. Miracle. It's correct. So you see that eventually the probability square, unpolarized, can just be written as a function of the masses of the electron and the muon, the initial and final particles, the energy of the initial particles, which is basically related to the total energy in the center of mass frame, and the angle, which is basically the only free parameter after you fix the energy of the process, the angle of emission of the final muon. So the probability that the muon is emitted is indeed dependent on the final angle. The probability is not, so the emission, if you want, is not isotropous. Okay, so now we can put everything together and write directly, basically take this expression here and plug inside the formula we wrote before about the differential cross-section. Any question about the steps? These are all just relativistic kinematics, mostly. So, I guess, just one has to be careful with the factors. Then I'm going to erase this part. So now we can write d sigma in d omega in the center of mass frame. And if you use the formula that I wrote before, basically there are all these factors in the center of mass frame, and let me write it one extra step, you get the factor was 1 over 4 S Q1 in modulus over Q1 in modulus, and there was a 1 over 4 pi squared. There was a Q now from there E to the 4, and exactly that expression there. So I don't rewrite it again. Let me write also Q1 and P1 like we did here in terms of E squared plus M squared, blah, blah, blah. And let me call Q E squared over 4 pi alpha, define such a constant. Then if you do that, the final expression for the differential cross section will be alpha squared over 4s, and then now the factor I'm going to name it for you, 1 minus x mu over 1 minus x t to 1 half 1 plus x e plus x mu. I'm going to tell you what these symbols are. Plus 1 minus x e, 1 minus x mu, cos squared theta. So x e and x mu are basically these factors here. X e and x mu are basically the ratio of the mass over the energy of the particle. So that when the energy, the particle is at rest, this x is 1. When instead is ultra-relativistic, this x goes to 0. So this is the factor that comes from QI over PI. And this is comes from the probability angle. So you see that the final probability is indeed proportional to the coupling, alpha squared. It goes like 1 over the energy squared, and this is a generic property of high energy scattering of two particles, because you see, already from here, the scattering, the probability of 2 to 2 scattering is a dimensionless object. And it's a probability, so it cannot be larger than 1 with some normalization. But on top of that, from our formula, by kinematic factors, there was always a factor of 1 over energy squared. So at very high energies, cross section will always decay like 1 over the energy squared. At asymptotically large energies. Of course, if the coupling is very small, there could be intermediate region where the probability increases and basically doesn't decay immediately. But this is not the case. Now you see that if you increase the energy, the formula simplifies even further. So if you basically scatter electron with higher and higher energy, then you can neglect the masses of the particle, because all this factor x, xe and x mu, at very large energy goes to zero. So the limit of this differential cross-section at energy much larger than the mass of the neutron simplifies into alpha squared over 4s from here. You get 1, you get 1, this is 0, 0, this is get 1 cosine theta, so square. So it's 1 plus cos squared theta. So you see that in this limit, you get a higher probability, a higher cross section, to emit the particle when the angle is either 0 or pi. So that in this muon, in this limit, most muon come at more angle. Instead, if you go to the opposite limit, when xc and x, when x mu, for example, goes to 1, you produce the muon just at rest. This goes to 0, so the angular dependency here disappears, and you then produce muon also in the opposite direction. So the angular dependence also gives information, non-trivial information in this case. And of course, I don't need to also highlight the fact that this is the prediction of the theory, right? So you can perform the experiment, the experiment has been performed, and this formula will be checked against experiments, and all the terms in the formula, of course, matches with the experiment. So the dependence, the prefactor, the total number of events that you produce, is also function of the angles, match with the prefactor alpha squared, which is the same structure constant that you find in the hydrogen atom. The energy dependence is the same, the angular dependence is exactly what is predicted, also when you take into account the effect from the masses. Of course, this is the leading order formula. You may ask, what happens if you consider higher order terms? So if you go to next order, you start increasing the number of vertices, and this amplitude gets corrected by other Feynman diagrams. So you can have Feynman diagrams, for example, with four vertices like this, or like adding a synonic loop here, and so on. Of course, there are many more contributions, more complicated. All this correction will give you correction here, which would be suppressed by higher powers of the coupling. Of course, you have to do modulo square, so you get higher order in alpha. And so you get correction goes like alpha cubed, plus alpha to the 4, and so on. Of course, alpha is a small number, right, so 10 to minus 3. 10 to minus 2, and so all these other corrections give you smaller and smaller numerical correction that, however, despite that they are small, they introduce a different energy and angular dependence on the of the output, so it can be tested independently. And finally, since we now know the dependence on the angle for the amplitude, we can also integrate over the angles. So we can also compute the total cross-section. Yes?
Okay. I didn't really get the physical implication of what happens when x and x mu goes to 1.
So, when they cannot go to 1 at the same time, right? In particular, x cannot go to 1, because if x goes to 1, it means that the energy of the process is the mass of the electron, but then it will not be enough to produce the muon. So the minimum energy to have this process here is must be at least the energy to produce the muons. Otherwise, you cannot satisfy the constraint from the Dirac delta of the conservation of thermodynamics. And which is, so the minimum energy for the electron is basically the mass of the muon. So the, when the electron, sorry, when the, this energy goes to the mass of the muon, basically x mu goes to 0. Now, when x mu goes to 0, of course, these terms simplifies. This becomes 2. The probability is of order 1. But what happens is that, well, sorry, it's of order QE to the 4. So it's finite. But despite the probability for this process to happen is 1, the cross-section goes to 0. And it goes to zero because of this prefactor here, 1 minus x mu to the 1 half. So when x mu becomes 1, there is an overall factor of zero that appears here. This is due to the fact that this momentum, three momentum of the final particle q1, goes to zero. This factor here, if you remember, was coming from the phase space of the two body that we computed at the beginning of this lecture. And the reason for this zero is the fact that basically the phase space allowed for the muon reduces to zero. Because when the energy reduces, the possibility for the muon to be produced reduces until they close completely when the energy is equal to the mass. So basically, if you plot the cross-section as a function of the energy at the mass of the muon, the cross-section goes to zero. And then it increases. This zero here is due to this factor here. And below, the process is not allowed by energy moving to conservation. So if you want, this is the threshold energy to actually produce a muon. And the probability goes to zero at that point.
Right.
Alright, so the last thing is just to now perform the integration over angles. Let's do it in the simplest case where you're going to high energy. Then all you have to do is just to consider sigma is equal to the integral in d omega, right? So the sigma in d omega, and this limit is, for example, alpha squared over 4s, 1 plus cos squared theta. This d omega, what it is d phi times d cos theta. Phi is integrated between 0 and 2 pi, so just give you 2 pi. This process doesn't depend on phi, only depends on theta, because the process is completely symmetric under rotation over the axis of collision. And the integral d cos theta must be taken between minus 1 and 1. So this gives you alpha squared over 4s. The integral of 1 to minus 1 and 1 is 2. So this is 2 pi and so on. And the integral cos squared theta and d cos theta is 2/3, right? So this is 8/3. So you see 1 hour and a half of calculation to get this. Actually, in this limit, the only dimensionful quantity that you have available is the energy of the process. So the fact that it was going like 1 over the energy squared, it's basically fixed by dimensional analysis. The power of alpha are just fixed by the number of vertices, square, modulo square. So all the calculation was just to get the factor 4 pi over t. I'm cheating because the principle of finite energy is non-trivial. Alright, so this is one example where you can see explicitly from the beginning to the end how to compute a cross-section of some process. And basically, thanks to this kind of calculations, one can test the theory and also measure the parameters of the Lagrangian directly by comparing the experiment. So, for example, the mass of the electron, the mass of the muon, the angular dependence, the alpha, the values of alpha, and so on. The angular dependence of the process actually critically depends on the particle that you use to interpolate this process. For example, you could have a different theory where instead of a spin-1 interaction, you had like a spin-0 interaction or some other type of interaction. In those cases, the angular dependence would be different. So from the study of the angular dependence, you can actually even reconstruct the spin of the mediating force that produce the scattering. I don't have more time. Maybe next time I'll make sure maybe for you. Okay, so then I will stop here. And let me know if you have more questions.